Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat episode 332, featuring a review of a game called XCOM 2. Now this game was just released last month, February 4th, and I've already put about 70 hours into it. I think it's utterly fantastic, and I really wanted to share my experiences and thoughts on the game with you. Anyway, we've got a lot of stuff to cover here, so without further ado, here is XCOM 2. And here we go, folks, with XCOM 2. Hell of a game, one of my new favorites, actually. I already put about 70 hours into it, beat it once. And playing it again for the purposes of this video already has me thinking about playing it again. Needless to say, I recommend it, but if you're not sure, then just watch this video and hopefully I will be able to convince you. Now you probably want to pick the easiest difficulty here, rookie, no shame in that. I'm going to go for veteran, I'm going to turn off the beginner VO. And because I'm feeling particularly insane, I'm going to enable Iron Man mode because I am feeling masochistic today.
Excitement continues to build as city centers across the globe prepare for the 20th anniversary of Unification Day.
Yay, Unification Day!
Keeping with their promise to humanity, 12 new gene therapy clinics will be opening in select cities by the end of the new year.
I told you Obamacare would work you out!
Operations at the new facility in Paris thankfully remain unaffected.
In response to the unprovoked intrusion on the eve of our most beloved
This is getting a little bit too close to home.
I'm a unifier. I know people are going to find that a little bit hard to believe, but believe me, I am a unifier.
Man, that guy is everywhere.
Have already made several preemptive arrests of known collaborators. Advent again.
Damn it! I just took the free personality test. I didn't even read Dianetics.
Operations will continue as planned.
Perfect. You know, all joking aside, I kind of like the sort of political social commentary angle here. Of course, this is all fictional events, you know, if you played the first game. In this one, the aliens have taken over. And the good guys have kind of been reduced basically to terrorism, or terrorists. Resistance fighters, if you will. Made me wonder if the developers here have some kind of message they're trying to get across. I don't really know. If you got some ideas, I'd like to hear your thoughts on it. Just in case you weren't clear who the bad guys were,
it's the scary looking alien guys. They can't speak English.
I'm glad they had that subtitled.
No.
Signal received. Loud and clear.
And the future of video is blue monochrome.
Okay, Gatecrasher. Your turn.
And weapons will have extra. Oh, I love this little dropship thing they've got here. I would love to make an appearance in one of those bad boys.
The aliens have had long enough to establish their peaceful enclaves within the city centers. It's time we move in and show them the fight isn't over yet. We're deploying to hit a high-profile target. One that they won't be able to cover up so easily. Move to secure the target site and eliminate any hostile contacts in the area.
Hearts and minds, hearts and minds. All right, so I skipped a little tutorial, but basically you've been working for the aliens all this time, brainwashed, some kind of special suit or whatnot. but they've rescued you and doctored you up a bit and apparently decided to put you in charge of the whole XCOM operation. I'm guessing these guys have never seen falling skies, but really, what could possibly go wrong?
We placed you at an inconvenient distance from the target. By the way, we can't just drop a bomb from the dropship because, XCOM.
And now we get to the fun part, the strategy, the tactics. They're getting killed a million times in a row and reloading. We're not going to do that. We're on Iron Man mode. So if we die, we die. And by the way, the reason they call it that is you better hope your mouse is made of iron, because otherwise it will probably be damaged by the third or fourth turn. Okay, so if you haven't played the other XCOMs, you're probably not watching this. But if you are, you basically have these things called action points. And some actions will end the turn, and other ones will let you have a second action after the first one. So for example, this blue zone is where I can move and still have enough action points left over to do something. There's another zone, if I go beyond that, it's yellow. Yeah, you see there, the yellow. And that'll end my turn if I move all the way over there. It's usually better not to end the turn just by moving. It's kind of a habit you get into as you play, because a lot of the levels have these really severe turn limits, turn time limits, basically. I'll bitch about those more later on in the video. But the important thing about the blue zone, or staying within that blue zone, is you will still be able to shoot. Or if you don't have a good shot, you can do something called Overwatch, which is basically a guard mode. And so if an enemy wanders into your line of sight, on their turn, you can still take a shot at them. And it's kind of sucky, because they really kill your accuracy for some reason when you go into Overwatch mode. Because after all, everybody knows it's very hard to aim a rifle when you're standing perfectly still. All right, let's see what we've got here. Got a nice little group.
Getting it done.
Now what you want to do is set up an ambush. So you can put a couple of your guys on Overwatch, and then just have one guy lob a grenade into the pack or shoot into the group, and that'll wake them up. And then they'll try to run to cover, but your guys on Overwatch will be able to take a shot anyway.
The advent officers seem more capable than the grunts. We're not sure whether to chalk it up to training.
Now I screwed up there because I accidentally got inside of that other group. So now when I'm seen, everybody will join in the combat. That's actually not very good. I probably would reload it at that point. If I were just kind of doing this for video entertainment, because that's probably going to cost me a couple of guys. You're really better off if you can just kind of sneak up and just take small groups on at a time, because this will be extremely difficult. Now those little red eyeball squares, if I wander into those, then the enemy will see me and it'll activate the combat, or I'll exit stealth mode. So you want to make sure you're in the best position possible before you do that. And it'll warn you, it makes that sound. A couple of times I accidentally hit the red square, so you have to be very careful. There's not very many bugs or glitches in this game. I had it crash a couple times, but overall it's very stable. But there's every now and then, yeah, like see there, I kind of screwed that up. I thought I was, okay. Yeah, he's not undercover. What is this, Sophie? Yeah, she's not undercover. She's just out in the open, so that was bad. You never want to have people out. I mean, these guys get critted. Not only do the enemies almost always seem to hit their targets, and you always seem to miss, but as if that's not enough, they almost always get a critical hit on you. So, you really don't want to be standing out. Okay, let's try this. So I'm going to hit these guys with my grenade. Cool! Wow, I got two killed. I thought I had the officer in there too, but it looks like he must have been out of the zone. So my guys on Overwatch will be able to take a shot at these guys. He's on fire. Let's see what these guys can do. She's out in the open. Alright, she got her target. He got his target. Wow. She got... Whoa! Okay. Now that never happens. That was lucky, 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 lucky. Those guys almost always miss their Overwatches. So, it's time for me to go buy a lottery ticket. Maybe they've dumbed this thing down a little bit since I played it last time. Starting to feel a little too easy. Uh-oh. Never mind. This is XCOM 2, baby. You're dead. No problem, I'll just reload. Iron Man mode. Yeah, so not a big deal to lose a raw recruit. You can get more of those, no problem. Later on, though, if you got like a captain or a colonel, highly upgraded troop, that would absolutely suck. You can always hire more recruits, but getting more advanced troops either takes time, or sometimes you can get them for quest rewards or just for money, but it would definitely be a very serious consideration. Die, bastard. That felt pretty good.
Target neutralized.
Area is secure. We're not picking up any inbound contacts. Scanners are clear. Menace 1-5, we have a limited window to act before Advent responds. We need to get those charges planted on the double.
So even though this quest doesn't have a time limit on it, eventually there will be reinforcements show up. And I guess they just keep coming and coming. So every mission, even if it doesn't have a time limit, you definitely don't want to be taking more time than you need. So I wasted a turn there trying to get her into position. Let's see. Usually when the reinforcements show up, you get a turn to... you'll see them coming. They'll put down these blue flares. That's always handy, you know. If you're going to drop into a zone, make sure you light it up real nice so everybody knows where you're going to land. But you can use that to set up your overwatches. And I've even thrown gas grenades into the zone, and they landed right on top of them and into the poison gas, which is pretty fun. All right, looks like we're good to go here. So that's the first mission. Nice little cutscene there. Okay, enemies killed 6 out of 6, soldiers killed 1, rating good. So that's considered good. I guess any mission that some people walk away from is a good outcome, right? Now, one of the things I appreciate about any game is when the designers have really paid attention to the small stuff. And you really see that here. Instead of just a boring old stupid loading screen with a bar on it and some stupid spinning elk or something, you actually see your troops coming to and fro, and their expressions and mannerisms change depending on the outcome of the mission. Completely awesome. Nice little touch, adds immersion, and makes what could be kind of boring actually into something cool that you look forward to. Alright, so once killed in action, the others are promoted.
Some of our most advanced equipment. Specialists deploy robotic drones on the battlefield that can be outfitted for combat or field medic duty.
Love the drones. You're gonna love the drones. Oh man. The drones have made the difference for me in many a battle. They can do damage and they can also heal depending on how you set them up.
Ranger serves as our primary reconnaissance unit, capable of moving independently in concealment while engaging enemies at close range.
Rangers are your total badass troops. I've actually killed, I think, maybe as many as 4 enemies with one turn with a ranger. They can get these bonuses where if they kill somebody with their sword, they can attack again. You're gonna love your rangers.
Just like it sounds, our sharpshooters engage enemy targets with pinpoint accuracy from extreme range. They're also trained in pistol marksmanship for the occasional close encounter.
Thinking just in terms of kill ratios, the snipers probably rule the roost. They got this awesome cone of death ability. Just, you can kill 3 or 4 enemies in one turn with that. It's not even on your turn. That's awesome. And their pistol is actually a very good weapon too. Later on they get a free pistol attack, which I probably killed more people with that than anything else. Let's go to the lab.
Commander, to the research lab.
Impressive, isn't it? Capable of generating immense power, yet completely harmless to human life. If only the same could be said for the rest of the aliens' technology. Commander.
Yeah, that's way better than Segways.
Dr. Richard Tigan, Chief Science Officer. I am responsible for the entirety of our research here, as well as the procedure you so recently underwent.
Oh great, the guy with Google glasses is operating on my brain!
I'm not sure what Central may have told you, but we found something while removing you from the alien stasis suit. A device implanted directly in your occipital lobe.
I always wonder what that port was for.
The equipment available to me during my tenure at Advent, I would already know the precise nature of its function. However, given time and your approval, of course, Commander, I assure you, I will find out.
Hey, it's making that sound again.
An additional point. Though aspects of this facility are indeed impressive, I am but one man. Were you to direct additional support personnel and resources to me, I could substantially improve the speed of all
these scientist types are always asking for a bigger budget.
Farewell, Commander.
In all seriousness, though, the research part of this game is awesome. And by the way, I didn't know this, but it was actually inspired by the Civilization, Sid Meier's The Civilization series, which kind of explains why it's so cool. But you can make all kinds of weapons, armor, get intel from these alien corpses, just all kinds of awesome stuff you can make, and the sooner you start researching it, the sooner you'll be able to use it on the battlefield. And these engineers are the ones who will make it for you.
Reworked your repulsors with some of the parts I salvaged from your old engine. Should fix that stabilization problem you had.
Not malfunction, Stephanie. Number 5 is alive.
Getting our tech to talk to theirs is harder than you think.
Woo, don't I know it. You ever try to set up a Dolby Atmos system?
You were probably expecting to see my father. In all that's happened, I'm guessing Central didn't tell you yet. He's gone. Dad gave everything he had to get us this far. This entire ship is his life's work. I know he would have loved to show you around the place himself. He used to talk about you a lot. You can be sure I'm ready to finish what he started. Might not look it, but from here, I can fabricate pretty much anything you come up with. And with a little more help, well, you'd be amazed at what I can do.
I may even be able to figure out how to hold a wrench!
I meet you, Commander.
So let's see what kind of cool stuff we can make already. Flashbang grenades, medkits, and smoke grenades. Basically, the way this works is some of these are instant builds, which means you can wait till you're ready for ready to go into a mission to make it. Just go ahead and make them. Others take time. And you have one of them, and that's one per mission. So even if you use it on a mission, you'll still have it for the next mission. That kind of threw me for a loop for a while. Okay, let's take a look here. This is a little different rooms on the Avenger craft. This kind of reminds me of the old cannon fodder game. Kind of bringing home the idea that real sacrifices are being made. Oh, this is kind of cool. So you can even, it looks like you can even type in a little epitaph there. So I wonder if anybody, do people get that attached? I don't know if that's cool or kind of scary. I guess you could really role play the hell out of this thing. And there's some history stuff here if you want to read about events in this game. And I believe it's got stuff from the previous game in there as well. So if you get tired of playing the game, I guess you can always come here and read for a while. I think this game had an appropriate level of text. I didn't feel like I was spending too much time reading, but I didn't feel like they skimped on the detail either. It's there. Sometimes I would skip over some of the text, but I didn't feel like I was just overwhelmed by it, like certain games that have come out recently that seem to assume you have an eternity to read. All right. Looks like my video is getting a little wonky there. I was using a Windows 10 built-in game recorder thing, so I don't know if I'll be using that again. Looks like it's going to clear up. Good. Should never trust that Microsoft technology.
Commander, good to see you on your feet again. Welcome to the bridge, the nerve center of our operation. The aliens have our entire world in their grip. Advent controls everything. Government, communications, industry. Not to mention the military. And it's on us to take it all back. Resources and time are tight, Commander. It'll be up to you to decide how to best use both. The ship is yours.
Now, he's not kidding about that. This game is all about resource management. You're going to need supplies, intel, and even parts from aliens and all kinds of weird alloys. It's just all kinds of stuff you need there. You can see at the top, intel, lyrium, alloys. And there's a lot of tough choices you have to make. You probably won't be able to get everything that you want, at least not on one playthrough. So it needs, there's a little bit of replay value there, right? The stuff you couldn't get the first time around, maybe the second time you play, you get that instead. But I like that. I like the having to make a tough choice. Let's see. So here's a reward for this one. I get another engineer. The engineers are cool for lots of reasons. one of the things they can do, this is their evacuate or basically clear out the debris in the ship. And when you do that, you not only get another room, you could put all kinds of, you could put a lab in there, workshop, power relay. But also when you clean out the room, you get some free stuff, supplies or those alien alloys I was talking about. And the more engineers you have, the more you can assign to these tasks. Later on, there'll be rooms that you can assign engineers to. And if there's engineers in there, they'll get all kinds of cool perks and bonuses. So basically, you can never have enough scientists or engineers. I would say if it's a choice between one of those and another recruit or some supplies or something, I would go for the staff. I also have a choice of places to scan. Has he already finished analyzing our chip?
So much of my own research based upon this simple design. If only I had known. Ah, Commander, excellent timing. There's been some progress. I've managed to break down several key components of the chip implanted into your skull. My analysis reveals that its primary function was that of a conduit, passing a vast amount of data directly to your cerebral cortex.
We call it the Vive.
The primary connection severed, much of that data is lost. Several fragments do remain, however. Ghosts, if you will. Observe. Tactical combat simulations. War games. The sheer volume of encounters you were processing was astounding.
So you've basically been playing XCOM 1 the whole time?
You survived as long as you did. Though this may seem disconcerting, there is still some good news. This chip bears a striking resemblance to a medical implant I briefly assisted in developing at the gene therapy clinic in New Providence.
Yeah, that's good news, Doctor.
Is that the implants were intended for high-ranking Advent officers only, captains or above. Retrieving a chip from such an officer would be the only way to know for certain. A greater understanding of these implants would undoubtedly benefit us all, Commander.
But especially Tara Reed.
New objective added.
I see lots of autopsies in this guy's future.
The officers have clearly been modified to allow for their subordinates to receive new orders psionically.
Why is he talking to you on a little screen when he's standing right in front of you?
The Advent officers appear to be similar, if not physically the same as the common Advent trooper in terms of power and agility. However, field reports indicate a more developed mental acuity, as the officers do provide tactical directives to the subordinate Advent forces.
Wouldn't it make sense to take the armor off first, Doc? Oh well. XCOM.
I must admit, having successfully completed the operation necessary to remove the commander's implant, I am intrigued by the possibility of examining another subject for comparative analysis.
I wish I had more supplies, because these buildings here are really nice. The Guerrilla Tactics one gives you some really nice perks on your troops, and the other one, the Advanced War School, or I forgot what it was called, lets you heal up your characters faster, if my memory serves. Now, the wounded character won't be able to join you on a mission, and you don't have an infinite supply of these, so it's nice to be able to heal them up quickly. A lot of people get into this character customizations. You can't just go with a randomly generated team, or you can get in here and... I mean, look at the details. Wouldn't it be tragic if I spent like 10 hours getting this character to look just right, and then she died in like the first 5 minutes of the next encounter? Is that foreshadowing? Nah, man, that's a cool helmet. Now you see, there's not enough helmets in games. When you talk to any soldier, and this is what they tell you, right? There's not enough helmets in films, in real life, in the battlefield. I mean, it's basically be suicide to be out there without a helmet on. So, I'm going to put a helmet on her. Let's see, punk. I guess there's not much point in the hairstyle. Maybe that's why they don't have more helmets in Hollywood, right? What would the hairstylist do? Okay, anything else to look at while we're here? Just go back to the bridge. Man, I love that. I wish I had that hologram globe thing in my mat cave. That thing looks so awesome. Okay, looks like we got our mission. Operation Chicken Face.
For the East African
No, I didn't make that up. That's what it's called. Let's go over there and see what we can do. So this is the group they've selected for us, but you can mix and match other troops. I kind of went back and forth between groups full of rookies, just so I could level them up faster. Of course, on the other hand, you really need the more powerful, more upgraded units to get through some of the tougher missions, so it's just a lot of decisions you have to make. I'll go ahead and, since I spent all my supplies building these items, I want to make sure that everybody's got them. I never really used the smoke grenades, but that definitely sounds useful. I'm not really sure what a flashbang would do. I guess maybe you could use it in an area where there were some civilians around. You wouldn't have to worry about killing them by accident. Not really sure what to do with those. This is a hacker mission. Now, some of these missions have a turn limit like you wouldn't believe. I said I would bitch about that, and a lot of people are bitching about that. So basically, they don't give you enough turns to complete the mission in anything resembling a sensible way. You pretty much have to guess exactly the path through the level that the designer intended. And if you deviate at all, or take even a little extra time, you'll fail the mission. If you're willing to reload it enough times, you can find a way to do it, but a lot of people didn't like it. And I really feel like they needed a couple extra turns on most of these. Maybe they'll fix that in a later patch. But it is, you know, it's exciting enough. I don't really feel like they needed such an intense time limit. You know, what I would like to see, maybe if you do it within that time limit, you get a nice bonus of some sort. But if, you know, you're late by three or four turns, it's you still complete it, you know, maybe without such a great reward. But the way it is now, it's kind of an all or nothing deal. And man, it was all I could do to complete these time missions. Alright, so I'm starting to get a little bit, this is what, the second mission? I'm already getting into some advanced tactics. We got upgraded recruits, and now they have specialties. And this one, the hacker can send a little, her little drone in there to hack that thing. I wasn't real impressed with the hacking in this game. Problem is, the almost every time I tried to do it, I only had, say, a 50% chance at best to succeed. And the penalty would be a whole extra wing of reinforcements. It just didn't seem worth it, so I never really used it. I don't know if there's some way you can improve your odds somehow. That was another issue, though. On the other hand, the nice thing about these drones, they can do damage to enemies, robots especially. Even if everybody else can't hit them for whatever reason, sometimes the drone can go in there and finish them off, if not kill them out outright. It's a guaranteed damage. So that's really nice to have. It might not sound as useful as it is, but once you get in here and start playing it, you're going to see real quick any character that has guaranteed damage is going to be a huge asset. All right, trying to decide how reckless I want to be here. So again, that turn timer, only 7 turns. That'll go a lot faster than you think. Now, ordinarily, it would be nice to take out this little group before I moved at all, so I wouldn't have to worry about moving into pulling another group in there, but the time limit being what it is, it's probably just should go for it. What I'm trying to think about here is the best way to set up my outwatch. You know, who do I want to have be on Overwatch? And sometimes you're better off not putting them on Overwatch, so you get that extra shot after they split. Sometimes they move into such a location that you might be flanked, so it's good if you have an extra turn. Okay, let's see. So what is this? See, 50% chance this thing is going to fail. And it says if it does fail, there will be extra enemies. So that's just a gamble. And it's probably not the kind of small intel cache, you know, big whoop. I think one thing it'll do for me, though, is get rid of those. Yeah, made a little easier to get by these guys without being seen. Now, I don't know if it's, maybe it's possible with some missions to actually get in there and to the hacking site without being seen at all. That would be pretty cool, and then you could just fight them after you had shut the thing down. But I'll tell you what, I think I'm going to go ahead and just go for this. My sniper's kind of just right out in the open, but if you move them at all, they won't be able to use the sniper rifle. Affirmative. Moving out. I guess I'll go ahead and do that. And let's see, Overwatch. She'll only be able to Overwatch with the pistol. Not the best weapon, but even with a pistol, the snipers are better than a lot of your other guys. Okay, let's see. Where are these guys going to go? Sometimes they'll walk right into your group, but I think... Nope, spotted. Oh, and this guy's in a really bad location. He's probably a goner. Whoa, my... missed? Wow, that's unheard of, man. The bad guy actually missed? I figured he would have been critted. Oh, there's my Overwatch. Man, it's like the game knows when you got the camera rolling and it makes it look a lot easier than it is. Okay, I want to show you this move. This Ranger is just really kick-ass. Look at this. Oh, man, that just never gets old. Now, unfortunately, she's a low-level Ranger, so she doesn't have any of those perks I was telling you about. Later on... Oh, crap. Oh, those sectoids are bad news. Ordinarily, the Ranger would be able to... Once you get a little higher level, she can actually move again after she kills somebody. So you could kill somebody and then run back undercover. But she's too low level for that. So, maybe I could actually use that smoke grenade. Let's see, maybe I'll just be able to kill this thing. Oh, missed. Yeah, get used to that, buddy. Come on, get a better scope or something. Alright, 28%. What the hell? Man, I don't know why this thing's so hard to hit. I really need to try to flank it. So that little yellow shield there means that I gotta try to move him or he's gonna probably be critted and dead. Alright, let's try this smoke grenade out. Never tried this before, but sounds like this would be, you know, if there's any time this will be useful, it'll be now. Let's see, is it actually gonna help? Let's see, what's this guy doing? Looks like he's going for a mind control. It's a panic. Okay, so should be pretty useless. Well, the panic is not as bad as the mind control. Seems like about half the time, they'll just mind control your guy, and then you have to try to kill the sectoid, or actually kill your own guy, because they'll start shooting you. And even though they miss all the time when they're shooting at aliens, for some reason when they're shooting at their friends, they're deadly accurate. Go figure. Oh, crap. Alright, so it looks like this smoke grenade's actually working out pretty good. There we go. So, once again, my Ranger comes through. See, I told you these Rangers were badass, man. So I think it'd be fun to play this game and have nothing but Rangers. Let's see, could she hit something right? Nope. That cardboard box was just too good a cover! God, the bullets just won't penetrate. You gotta remember that next time I'm in a firefight, man. Okay, let's see. This guy is behind a car. It's always a choice of, do you want to be in a pretty good, secure location, or do you want to get closer so you can actually have a chance of hitting the target? I seem to be having some pretty good luck with this smoke, so I'm just running right into it. Oh, there we go. Okay, so he is able to blast through the cardboard. Now that guy's just out in the open, but I'm out of turns. Okay, see, he's gonna... Oh, this is not gonna be pretty. Oh, critical, of course! Of course! Well, at least she's not dead. She's taking... She's not panicked, either. One thing, though, if you have a wounded warrior, so to speak, they'll get something called willpower... Oh, what's it called? Shaken, or something like that, and they'll basically suck next battle. They'll panic really easily and be useless. A couple times I fought through a really tough mission. One of these turn-based things, time missions, and I got the mission completed, and then there was some idiot that was panicked, and I could not get her to the evacuation spot. Had to reload. So, that is, that shaken thing is a big deal. Alright, got to pull another group there. But you see, ideally, you would just stay back here, let them come to you and pick them off, but that turn limit, gonna have to go in. This shouldn't be too bad. Another thing about the snipers, they do a lot better if they're on at height. Most of the time there'll be a roof or even sometimes a guard tower or something you can put them on top of. Okay, let's see. Will I hit? It would be a miracle. He actually hit it. Pistol, let's see. Pistol. Nope. Wow, those sectoids, they've got a lot of armor. You can't see it. But they've got, oh. This is going from bad to worse. So she's mind controlled. If I can take out that sectoid, that would... Oh. Come on, Ranger. If I just... No, I had her behind that air conditioning unit. The cardboard would have been a much better choice. Okay, God! If you were in such a hurry, why'd you land me so far away? Butthole. Alright. Come on. Ooh, 88% chance. You know, I'm just going to go for this. I don't want to run out of time. Okay, good. All right. Okay, that was good. Now I killed the sectoid, so that should free up the other... Yeah, okay. Mind control lost. Okay, breathing a little easier now. I think I might actually get through this. Run her up. I know there's one other alien down there, but... If you don't get to that computer, the mission will be failed and all this will be for nothing. 35% chance? What the? Ah. On my way. Okay, I don't think she's going to hit with a 35% chance. Oh, screw it. You know what? I'm just going to grenade it. Man. Okay, destroyed the house. Positive confirmation. Okay, it's dead. Alright, so now it should be just a simple matter of... going in there. You know, these guys, they tickle me the way they run around this battlefield. I mean, if there's an open window, an open door, doesn't matter. They just love breaking through windows. They love climbing over stuff, jumping over stuff. So much easier to, you know, jump over a car than it is to run around it. Okay, looks like I... Oh, crap. Don't quite have enough action. Yeah, there we go. Don't quite have enough. What kind of house is this? There's no... There's a ladder instead of stairs? Okay. How many of you guys have ladders to get into your house? Yeah, I don't know if I'd want to be climbing onto the roof of a burning house, but okay. Get your butt in there! Come on! This is probably where one of those mods would come in handy. Ugh. What does it take to shut this guy up? He's so annoying, man. What's really annoying, you get on these missions where you have to rescue people before the aliens shoot them down. And that, every time one of them dies, you're already pissed off about it. And then that guy has to come on there and say, oh, hurry, yes, it's mass slaughter out there. Come on, Commander, do your job. Man, I think I would save one bullet for him when I got back. This is real life. Alright. Okay, so that's two missions. It's looking good. I'm going to go ahead and load the my later save there. I'm going to show you the end. But a little bit later in the game so you can get a feel for how it scales. And one of the things, I think they really, even better than the first game, nailed that civilization-like tech tree aspect to the game, if you know what I'm talking about. You know, there's always something just around the corner. It'll be a real game changer. A lot of these upgrades will change your tactics. I mean, real fundamental stuff. So there's a lot of excitement. So that one more turn phenomenon. Okay, go ahead and put my sniper up here on the roof. You say roof or... Oh, shh. I say we're screwed. That's how I pronounce it. Okay, and she's in a bad look. Oh, okay. So, in real life, this would be a reload moment if there ever was one, but these little glittery women, fire star-like women, fire women, oh man, they are so annoying for reasons which will become clear. Running into two of them, that is, oh, and that little godlike character with the fire coming out of him is not very easy either. And that big robot thing on top of this is pretty bad news, too. So basically, I am completely and utterly screwed. These would be hard enough if I took them on one pack at a time. Eh, but what the hell. There's my EMP grenade. Those are really, really useful against robots. See, check this out. So, no damage to the environment. But he shut down for two turns, and he took a lot of damage, and it went right around his armor. Unfortunately, I've only got one of those. It'd be nice to have more than one. So sometimes you just can't get past a battle. You know, the robot's too tough or whatever. Just restart the mission and change up your equipment. Sometimes that'll make a huge difference. Here's that cone of death I was telling you about. The kill zone. So the only limitation there is your ammo. Which every now and then you get this option to upgrade your weapons with a bigger clip size. So always pick that. I don't know. It's just my advice and what worked for me. But I always wanted to have as many, you know, as big a clip as I could get in those sniper rifles. Because if you have, say, 6 or 7 shots in the kill zone, you know, that can turn the whole tide of a battle. I've actually seen them kill 4 or 5 people all in just with the kill zone. Here's one of my, what do they call these, psychics, basically. She's got something here called Soulfire. And by the way, you have to build a special facility to train these troops, these Sinus, I think they're called. But, oh man, so worth it. So worth it. Look at that. Look at that. You got armor on? Don't care about armor. I use my mind to kill. Yeah, that little, they got kind of strange haircuts, but man, let me tell you, you will be so happy to have them along. You're still kind of low level. I mean, you get those Psionis up high enough, and they can do the mind control, and they just got some really awesome abilities. I highly recommend that you start working on those as soon as possible. And these, there's my drone. So she's got a 51% chance. Let's try the combat protocol. Now this will send the drone over there and do guaranteed damage. Not a lot of damage. It's probably not going to be all that great here. But you know, if one of them's wounded or something, and you just want to get it out of play, that can be very useful. It's really the most useful when you got something with a lot of armor on and just a couple of points left. See, here they go. So every time you hit one of those, if you don't kill it outright, it's going to half its hit points and split into two. And then they can also teleport, and they're just always flanking you. They're just horrible. These guys, I think that's... okay, maybe I'll be able to kill him. Come on, Mr. Sniper. This guy looks straight out of The Witcher. Oh, still got some points left. Oh, what's happening here? 10 points of damage? Oh God, what was that? All right, come on, Witcher. Oh, I missed. What good's a sniper that can't hit his targets? Oh, okay. They don't seem to have that problem. So again, this is it's painful for me to continue, even though I know it's just kind of a demonstration. It's all I can do not to reload this thing. You know, I hate that. Missed. I mean, ordinarily, if I wasn't going to reload this, that would be horrible, because she was like a colonel, I think. You know, very high-level sniper. You guys that are playing this with Iron Man mode and on the tougher difficulty levels, I don't know how you do it. So look at that ability. So now I got to reload. All the weapons are useless, and I'm going to have to waste part of their turn reloading it. And on top of that, I got to haul ass, because if I don't get out of that blue misty stuff, they're going to take heavy damage. I mean, it's enough damage to kill most of them, so let's see. She's panicked on top of everything. Oh, man. How bad can this situation get? This guy does have a grappling hook that he can use, but I'm going to just use his pistol. Maybe I can turn the tides a little bit here. I guess his pistol wasn't affected by that weapon disabling ability. And let's see, how do I want to end here? Okay, you have to, there's some way you got to tell it to use your pistol. There we go, fire pistol. 86% chance. Got her. Okay, I'm liking him better. The national pride kicking in there. I wonder if you can make your own flag. I like the Matt Chat Nation. I bet you that's probably a function. Okay, so I got this. This guy can launch a grenade, but it's kind of hard to get a lot of enemies. I didn't find too many opportunities when you could take out more than two at a time. You know, it's almost as if the AI is smart enough not to bunch up to avoid grenades. Oh man, that's a miracle. Those things almost always crit me. Okay, let's see, can I do it? How many? I wish I could get that one to standing outside, but it doesn't look like that's gonna happen. I think that's probably as good. Oh, a little glitch there. So every now and then you'll hit the fire button or something and it won't work. So there's tiny little glitches like that in here, but it doesn't make that big of a difference. Okay, got one of those. I forget what they call those fire women, but she's gone. This guy just got a battle frenzy. That doesn't sound good. Where to put her? Oh, crap. Oh, fire butt. Ah, missed again. Man, I am just really getting lucky today. Let's try insanity. Come on, babe. Let's do this. Come on. Oh, missed. Yeah, I kid you not. Many times I've had, like, say a 90, maybe even like a. I think one time I had a 99% chance, and still missed. So I guess you statisticians would say, oh well, that's random. Just because it's more likely doesn't mean you can't miss. You could have a 90. I guess you could have a 99% chance of hitting and miss like five times in a row. Not unheard of. Okay, got her. Boom. Now that's a drone for you. That right there is why you want these drones. Guaranteed damage. And see, some of these things, if they've got one health point left, they could still really screw up your party. I'm kind of miffed because there's like a piece of equipment there. I got two turns to reach it. It's probably really good, but I don't know any way I can get there in two turns. Especially not with these guys. Oh, God. Nine points of damage. God, I don't know how these. It seems like the aliens just do so much more damage than your guys do. I'm doing like 4 points of damage. They're doing 9, 8. Yeah, this is probably not going to happen. You know, somehow I still got to get to that guy, knock him out, carry him to the evac point. So, anyway, I think this is a good enough of a tour of XCOM 2. Should give you a pretty good idea. I actually love this game. I don't know if that's coming across in my commentary. I did spend about as much time cursing at it at top volume as I did enjoying it, but... You know, I don't know if you've played games like that. They kind of piss you off, but it's like at the same time you're actually enjoying it somehow. Maybe I'm sick. You know, maybe I should go to a psychiatrist or something. But I just thought this was an awesome game. Highly recommend it. You'll definitely have your reloading moments. Unless you're just a real masochist, I wouldn't play on that Iron Man mode. Try one of the easier modes. Or, you know, go ahead and just reload until your heart's content. One nice thing is it loads pretty quick. You know, I hate it when you play on a game that's really hard and you have to keep reloading and it takes forever. You know, this one was nice and quick, at least on an SSD. So it wasn't a big deal. Let you save anywhere. So of course, you know, every time you're doing pretty well, just keep saving it. Make sure you've got multiple saves, but of course you know that. Anyway, there you go. XCOM 2. I think this is one of my favorite games in a long time. I actually picked this up on Steam as part of a bundle. They had this and the Steam controller. So somehow, when you did all the math, you basically saved $20 to get in the Steam controller in this game. And I don't know about that controller. I haven't made up my mind on that yet, but I think this game was definitely worth it. I don't know how much it's running for now, but you know, if you like the first XCOM, I don't know why you wouldn't enjoy this one too. If you like good strategy games, if you're kind of into the Civ style game, I think you would like this. If you're not familiar with XCOM, don't worry about it. There's still plenty to enjoy here. It does have one gaping rat-shaped flaw. I don't know what their quality control people were thinking. They should all be fired. But all in all, you're going to love this game. Go ahead, pick it up. XCOM 2, money well spent. And that's all for this week's episode. Hope you guys enjoyed that. I should be back next week with a new interview series. Now, let me, I'll ask you guys what you want to see next. I got an interview with Julian Gollop, who actually designed the first XCOM game, but also have another interview with Volker Wertig, the father of the Settlers, one of the great Amiga classics. Anyway, I can go either way, so if you have a preference for one or the other, let me hear from you. Otherwise, I will just do them in the order I recorded, which would mean starting with the Wertig. In any case, I thank you very, 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 very much if you have supported Matt Chat. You're keeping these episodes coming, guys, and I don't expect a lot of cash for this. My God, no. If you like to watch these episodes, if you wouldn't mind putting a little dollar into the tip jar, that's really all I ask. Just go to the Patreon site in the show notes, sign up for a Patreon account. Painless, easy, simple, and you'll be supporting the show in no time. And you'll feel really good. But anyway, you guys that are already and gals that are already supporting the show, thank you. You guys are awesome. And thank you for your continued support of the show. Now, what about that news from the Matt Cave? Alright, so let's see. I guess the top news is, of course, Tyranny. This is a game. It's called, if you go to Tyranny Game, I think that's the website. I just don't leave out the Y. This is from Obsidian and Paradox. They brought you Pillars of Eternity. Now they're doing this game, and the twist is you're playing on the side of evil. Now it's not quite clear to me. Maybe I should have actually read the rest of the text there. But It looks like you could play this as a good guy, or you could side with the evil bastards, your pick. Anyway, that seems to be the twist on it. It's supposed to be due out actually this year. We'll see if they stick to that. But anyway, Stig and a couple other people wrote in about this. Of course, very exciting. I'm going to try to see if I can get one of the folks working on it onto the show so we can hear some more details, a little bit more about sort of what they're thinking with this game and how it will be different than Pillars. Let's see what else we got here. Alan Vallely sent this in. This is a slasher backer campaign, aka not a slacker backer campaign, for this Friday the 13th game. Now, this was kickstarted a while back, I believe last year, successfully kickstarted. But if you missed out on that Kickstarter, you can still get in on this slasher backer campaign at $60 for a physical copy. And Alan said he was intrigued by the 1v7 gameplay, and that the camp counselors, apparently there's reasons for them to backstab each other built into there. Anyway, it looks like a pretty interesting project. It is a little bit on the gory side, I'll warn you, before you head over there. But anyway, it looks pretty interesting. And of course, Alan's actually the guy that got me a lot of these, he was the eBay agent, I guess you could say, for a lot of these games here you see behind me. So always happy to help him out. And let's see what else we have here. Neil Halford, big news from old Neil Halford, remember him? He was on the show not too long ago. He is doing a project called Betrayal at Krondor Remastered. And it's a little bit to wrap your head around here, but this is a not-for-profit project. He's doing this pretty much to teach himself how to use this tool called Amazon Lumberyard Game Engine. So it sounds like the plan is to release videos or blogs as he's working on this. But anyway, I'll post a link in the show notes so you can go check that out. Anything from Neil Halford is definitely worth a look. If you're, of course, a Betrayal at Krondor fan, you'll be excited for this. But anyway, I'll see if I can learn some more about that and share it with you next time. course, if you have any information about any of these items, please chime in the comment section. All right, what about that ale of the week? Well, this week I've got something really special. This is a, along with some beers that were sent to me from Sweden by some fans of the show named Maria and Jim. So New Orleans Gould Juice, 4.7 Ecologisk. I'll read this in a second, but the juice, I looked that up on Google Translate, and it means kidney processed. Not exactly sure what that entails, but I'm really looking forward to trying that. And Marie and Jim also sent along a letter. I thought I'd read part of this to you. Hello, Matt. Thank you for all the hard work you put into all the interviews we get to enjoy. Well, you're very welcome. We wanted to get you something typically Swedish, but failed to figure out what. But instead, you get a few other goodies with the beer. So they had sent some candies and beef jerkies and some really fun stuff I have no idea how to pronounce, but looking forward to trying. The beer, Arboga Ole, is not local anymore, but the recipe is the same, and to get you a bottle instead of a beer can, we had to order 15 of them. Since we don't drink that much, Maria's brother got some. The other two bottles we bought because of the looks of them, people say they are really good though. Now that is a good tip. Usually a beer or wine in a really cool bottle. It's, you know, it's my theory of if the small things, right? So if they take the time to really make a cool looking bottle and label, they probably care about the beer as well. So it's a pretty good chance to take. Well, let's see, you get some candy and beer sausage. Beer sausage? That sounds interesting. So you should share them with your family, and we hope you enjoy some of them. It's really fun to see that you live in Minnesota, since Maria's family has many long-distance Swedish relatives there and in Michigan. We have a list with about 3,000 people who have lived their life over there. Well, we really hope this package reaches you intact. It did, so good job with the packaging. Thank you again for everything you do. Best regards from Maria and Jim in Sweden. P.S. Please do not read this on your show. We wish to remain anonymous. Oops. Anyway, thank you very much, Maria and Jim. Really looking forward to trying this out. Anyway, let's get this open and see what it's all about. All right, so I got some of this New Orleans Gould Juice 4.7 Ecologisk. Man. This. I'll be back in about 15 minutes. I don't even need to drink this. I could just sit here inhaling this. I mean, it smells amazing. It smells like a good Belgian honey. I mean, just an amazing aroma on this. If you like Belgian wheats, I think this would really fit the bill. It almost tastes like one of those, or smells like one of those good Belgian Trappist monk ales. I mean, Abbey Ale. I mean, if it smells even anywhere near, if it tastes as good as it smells, definitely for a treat. Anyway, so I'm told the way to say cheers in Swedish is skål, which I know because I am a skål teacher. So let's give this a taste. All right, so what do we have here? It doesn't taste like it smells a lot like a wheat, but it definitely does not taste like one. Instead, we got more of a sort of a lager taste, I would say. It's kind of got a little bit of a peachy citrus-like flavor to it. It's, I would say, relatively light. It's got a pretty good head on it here, but it's not a real heavy drink. Let me try it again here. Yeah, it's good. You know, I would say this would be one that you would want to drink in the summertime when it's really hot outside, if you're coming in from mowing the grass or whatever it is you do, slaying rats out in the hot sun. You'd want to come home to a nice Juice Gould. Try it one more time here. Yeah, so really, really tasty. You know, if you're looking for something with a lot of punch to it, you know, you probably wouldn't like this. But if you want something a bit on the lighter side, a bit on the refreshing side, and you like a sort of a citrusy taste, I think this would fit the bill, and it smells really, really good. So I'm going to go 4 out of 5 of Drinking Horns on this one. I wish I could be even anywhere close to the right pronunciation on this, but New Orleans Gold, LJUS, you know, hunt this one down. I think you will enjoy it. So 4 out of 5 Drinking Horns, and once again, thank you very much to Maria and Jim. All right, let's wrap this up with a quotation. And I was looking for quotes about aliens, and I found one by a famous physicist. It goes something like this. If aliens visit us, the outcome would be much as when Columbus landed in America, which didn't turn out well for the Native Americans. Well, the quotation there by Stephen Hawking. See you guys next week.
God, I'm so stupid!
Stupid, foolish, gullible, doltish, dumbbell, lingering. Shut up, silence, hush, sit on it, candid.
Boy, am I the jerk of the world, you just programmed.
Jerk of the world, turkey, idiot, pain in the ass.